Hi everyone, thank you very much for joining us on this webinar, where we'll cover the 2019 infrastructure public disclosure data set that we have put together. It's really been a great journey to get all the way here, and we will be using this webinar to sort of go over and try to explain, first of all, for the few of you on here who are not familiar at all with GRESB, so what it is we do. And additionally, then we'll try to give you an explanation of what exactly this public disclosure data set attempts to provide, what kind of gap in the market it's looking to address, and most importantly, how we can get you as participants to fill out the data, as well as the types of reports that it can provide for investors. So this webinar initially was created or prepared with the idea of being an interactive information session. So I will try to include some pauses in between the slides as I go through them, which should allow for some questions from the audience if there are any. The way that it'll function, because most of you will, or all of you will be on mute for now, please address your questions or direct your questions to the chat box that we have in the bottom right-hand corner of your WebEx page, and we will then attempt to address them all. Make sure that when you select or when you try to enter your message, that you make sure that it's being sent to all attendees, so that everyone else can see it, and that we can have a, you know, a good discussion going on. So the knowledge that we're going to share in here is pretty cross-cutting. It's not only going to apply to the public disclosure data set, the assessment that you fill out, but it can also apply to the other assessments which GRESB offers. So in that sense, it has multiple uses. So let's get started. My name is David Tassado. I'm an infrastructure analyst at GRESB for just over a year and a half now. I'm joined here by Fraser Hughes, the CEO of GLIO, who will be speaking later on in this presentation. And he will also be addressing the work that GLIO has been doing to, in order to help us reach this stage of the project. GLIO bring a lot of listed infrastructure knowledge and experience to this whole project. So maybe let me just go over the agenda really quickly. So I will go ahead and introduce GRESB to those of you who don't know what it is we do exactly, and give you a bit of, you know, the structure and the environment in which we work, as well as then moving on to the GLIO and GRESB partnership. So as I mentioned earlier, GLIO have helped us a lot in getting this infrastructure public disclosure project off the ground. And hopefully through Fraser's interaction or this little presentation, we'll be able to identify the gaps that, you know, the listed infrastructure space currently has in terms of ESG data and how we are addressing that. Then we'll really delve into what we're here for, and which is, what is the infrastructure public disclosure project? How can you fill it out on the portal using our reference guide to guide you, and then walking you through certain examples of indicators that we have selected to, you know, help you fill it out better when you amend your data. And lastly, we'll have a look at the output and the scorecards, which are made available to the investors. So what is GRESB? Well, our mission is to enhance and protect shareholder value by assessing and empowering sustainability practices in the real asset sector. The way that our business model works is that we provide certain assessments, which on one hand we use to assess various real asset companies in the real estate and infrastructure sectors and industries. So they will provide us with the data and sustainability ESG data that they have. We in return will provide them with reports that will have benchmarked them and standardized scores of these assessments versus their peers and the rest of the industry. Whilst on the right-hand side, we can also see that our investors will receive the reports of the investments of the companies in which they invest in. And in return, they will provide us further feedback on how we can improve the assessment. So GRESB, one of its core strengths we believe is that we're by industry for industry, so we work a lot with our stakeholders to try and improve the assessment that we have and that we provide to the industry. So originally, on the infrastructure side, we had two complementary assessments. So if we forget the public disclosure assessment for just a short while, we originally coordinate a fund assessment and an asset assessment, which run once a year. And the way that it works is that a fund will be able to participate with us. And if sufficient assets within their fund also participate with us, they get what we see here in the middle, which is a GRESB score on the fund. And essentially, that is the essence, I think, in these last three slides that would best describe, in a nutshell, how GRESB functions. I think what I would like to do next is to invite Fraser Hughes to give a small presentation on GLIO and how how they came about and the project work that they've been doing with us. So Fraser, please go ahead.
Thanks, thanks, David. Dave, do I ask you to move on the slides, I guess?
Yeah, sure.
Look, very very quick background to GLIO. We were established in 2016 to promote investment in the listed infrastructure companies at a global level, and also to help the specialist global listed infrastructure managers build their assets under management. What's important here is to recognize that we're only focused on the core infrastructure companies, or the mission critical infrastructure companies as we call them, and that covers at a global level about $2.5 trillion worth of market cap collectively. And if you move on, Dave. So like I said, we were established in 2016. We were initially backed by the specialist global infrastructure managers. So we had 10 founding members, and they will have come from, you know, companies like Cohen & Steers, Macquarie, and DWS, and I think many of those companies or managers are on your shareholder register. We've managed to grow the organization quite impressively, I would say, over the last 3 years. We're now up to 55 members, and that will be a mix of the listed companies and the specialist GLI managers. So it's about 50-50 mix between those members. If you look at the listed companies themselves, in terms of market cap, collectively, they represent about $450 billion in market cap, or in enterprise value, that's probably closer to about $700 billion. If you move on, please. Okay, so what do we actually do? I mean, really, this is about creating more investor awareness for the asset class. Yeah, how do we go about this? I mean, it's really about the research that we do on behalf of the asset class collectively. We do quite a lot of industry research, and many of you are on the GLIO distribution list, and you'll see the monthly research that we push out into the market that gets to about 3,500 contacts globally at this point in time. We've also started to stimulate some academic research as well. I think this is important when we're building up a library of research that's, at the end of the day, going to convince investors to look seriously at the asset class. So it's really about a nice mix of academic and industry research that we're putting out into the market. The focus of that research is based on the GLIO coverage. And as I said earlier, that covers about $2.5 trillion of market cap. It's about 140 companies in absolute terms. And it's really all about how investors can use both private infrastructure investment and listed infrastructure investment as well. So how they can blend the two types of vehicle to build up an infrastructure allocation. We're also focused on the multiples in the market. So we do quite a bit of research now that compares enterprise value, EBITDA multiples in the private market and the listed market. And generally what you find there is that individual infrastructure transactions, they'll happen over and above what we see in the listed market. So that's quite a nice tool that we can get out, or quite a nice message that we can get out to investors. And we'll also compare global listed infrastructure versus the equity market, the bond market, et cetera. I think key in this slide is really the working relationship that we've built with GRESB. I mean, really from day one of GLIO, we went up to Amsterdam, we met with the guys at GRESB with a view to building out our ESG expertise and promoting ESG to the broader investment community. And just very quickly on the regulatory front, we've built a good working relationship with the OECD, and we're also looking at other types of vehicle that may well help the asset class going forward, one of those being an infrastructure investment trust, which is effectively a REIT or a real estate investment trust specifically designed for infrastructure. Okay, Dave. Okay, I think this is quite a nice slide to show how specialist global listed infrastructure managers have grown over the last 10 years. So on the left-hand side of the chart, we see what's actually happened in this space. On average, between 2010 and 2018, funds under management growth in absolute terms has been about $7.5 billion per year. Also, what this graph does incorporate, so it's key to break out what's happened in share price movement. So share prices on average, and this excludes dividend yield. Share prices have moved up around about 6%. And I could say capital coming into the asset class is about $7.5 billion. People always ask, okay, you know, how is that going to look going forward? How are we going to benefit as a listed company in the asset class? What I've done here is put together what I think is quite a conservative forecast on where we're going to be in 10 years. And if you look at average share price growth, which is slightly less than what we've experienced in the 10 years previously at about 5%. And if you look at funds under management growth, and again, slightly less than what we've experienced historically of 7 billion, we hopefully, if we do our job right, we'll hopefully be touching on an asset class with funds under management of about 250 billion by 2028. Now, like I said earlier, I think this is conservative. I think under the right conditions, we can grow this more than these estimates. And I think one of the fundamental messages that we've got to get across is that listed companies perform well in ESG terms. I mean, we all know that, ESG comes up in all of the meetings now that you're doing with both the managers, plus also the pension funds and sovereign wealth funds. So I think we can really hammer home that message that the listed companies perform well in ESG terms. Okay, Dave. Very quickly, this is just a list of the GLI managers that currently make up the 100 billion or so in funds under management. I mean, you can see that's grown quite considerably, I would say, since 2004. And I would expect more and more managers to come into the asset class over the next 5 to 10 years or so. Okay. Okay, and I guess everybody, you know, clearly understands what the key benefits of listed infrastructure are. I mean, very quickly going through, I mean, we only cover the core or mission critical economic infrastructure companies. You know, we believe this is a long or a mid to long term proxy for private infrastructure investments. So it can either act as an alternative or a complement to private infrastructure allocations. If you look at our 2.5 trillion of market cap, I mean, we're diversified across four regions, across it's about 20 countries, and across four main core economic infrastructure industry groups as well. Historically, we've given really nice long-term risk-adjusted returns, very attractive yield in that, around about 4% on average. Of course, all of this is underpinned by stable cash flows of the companies that we select. And again, I mean, key in these messages is that these listed infrastructure companies will offer very good ESG disclosure on average. And I think, I think David will go into this a little bit later on. If you look at our pilot study of last year, those listed infrastructure companies actually performed better in disclosure terms than listed real estate. So that kind of falls under this real assets umbrella. So right from the start, I think the messaging there is very good. And, you know, last couple of points is, you know, generally there's a good inflation linkage to those listed infrastructure companies. Defensiveness versus the other asset classes is really good. We did do a lot of research on this on a regular basis, which you can pick up from our website. And a lot of those points you can pick up, and you see the link to the website there from the GLI 101 section of the GLIO website. As well. Okay, last slide, my side. This is an advert that we do in the main real assets investment press, and it's just to say, really, look, this is an emerging asset class. In the text, we'll kind of reiterate all of those points. You know, the benefits of investing in listed infrastructure companies. And I think the final sentence, you know, there's a focus there on, you know, really the demands of investors in an ESG aware global economy of the future. So for more information about the organization, of course, you can go to the website, and I think I can take questions if there are any at this stage.
I don't see any questions yet on the platform, so I think it's relatively clear the group it seems.
Okay.
All right then. Great. Well, thanks for that. We'll move on to now discussing really what is this infrastructure public disclosure data set that we've been working on. So to set a bit of a background or a bit of a story to it, we realized at one point that it was becoming apparent, actually, that there was no real database that is dedicated to providing ESG data, specifically to the listed infrastructure companies and vehicles out there. And so what GRESB wanted to do was to use its experience and knowledge within this field of ESG to somehow fill this gap. And therefore, using what was originally the real estate public disclosure data set, we tweaked and adapted that assessment to fit the infrastructure, the listed infrastructure industry. And we have now developed this collection method, which allows us not only to fill this gap, but to allow for us to have a data set that has a really good coverage of the investable universe. This year, we began by collecting the entire GLIO Global Coverage Universes Index, and it's allowed us to pioneer in this industry, in this infrastructure industry, and it has a pretty interesting functioning. So the way that this assessment works is that typically in the GRESB assessments, it's always the data coming in from the companies to GRESB. However, here the role is reversed in part because we go out and collect all publicly available information that's out there on the listed infrastructure companies. So it can come from their public websites, annual sustainability or integrated reports, as well as certification databases and registries. We then allow the participants, and which is where we are now, to come in and amend the data. Once you've amended the data points, we will actually come in and validate it again, so to try and standardize all the data once again. And finally, we'll release the results on the 4th of September and in scorecard format on the 10th, I believe, for every company for which we collected data. All the scorecards that we create using this publicly available information, each individual one, is made available to any investor who is subscribed as a GRESB listed investor member. And so that's sort of how the data is made use of. What's really crucial to highlight is that currently, unlike our asset and fund assessments, the infrastructure public disclosure data set and the way that the points are sort of awarded revolves much more around transparency. Its emphasis is not yet, so we're going to move towards it, but it's not yet rewarding performance too much. So it does reward performance, but it's not what is really emphasized. And so that's really important to keep in mind before we move forward. However, it does give you a very good barometer of the transparency that these companies have with regards to sustainability and the various ESG topics. So it can be a good first filter for many investors. So getting started, so you as participants will be here to better understand how can you actually fill out this assessment. So let's begin with how you want to log in at first. We sent out an invite email, which many of you will have, well, hopefully everyone here has seen. If you have not received it and you heard about this webinar through some other channel, you can always request the email or the link from us. And this email and the link that's contained within it will direct you to the response that belongs to your company on our portal. Once you click on it, if you have a user account, you can log in and view it. If you are not yet a user on the GRESB portal, you can create an account and view it from there. So once you've logged into a portal, how do you actually view your assessment? Well, first, if you get shown this first screenshot that I have here, if you land on a page which has this screenshot, you can click on view assessments. However, if for some reason you do end up somewhere else, you can't find your way, always look to the right of your screen when on the portal, and you should be able to find a button that's called Assessment Portal. Click on that, and it'll direct you to the screenshot that you can see here. Next, you want to click View Assessments, and then followed by Review and Submit. So once you've clicked on that Review and Submit button, you'll be shown a Content button, which you can use to direct yourself to whichever section of the public disclosure assessment that you want to have a look at. And from there, you're good to go and to start having a look at what we actually filled out for you. So each question that we have, we refer to at GRESB as an indicator. So these indicators each have a very specific guidance that follows it. And this guidance is provided by what we call the reference guide. The Infrastructure Public Disclosure Reference Guide is available and was sent to you in the email and on our resources page on our website. For each of the indicators, this Public Disclosure Reference Guide will offer you the intent behind the indicator, the terminology and the definitions of what we're referring to, the requirements to fill in the indicator, and how the scoring works for it. It also includes, for those of you who are very interested, who might be interested, the references to the other frameworks that we use. So GRESB doesn't come up with everything on its own. We try very hard to work with the rest of the industry to come up with a concise and well agreed upon set of indicators. So
those are also available in there. So once you're viewing your assets or your fund for which we've collected data on, it's really crucial to go to the Manage Entity button, which I've highlighted here in the screenshot, and make sure that the data that we have filled out as your reporting period and the entity's location of the headquarters is correctly filled out, because A, the reporting period is really crucial in the decisions that we take, because depending on the reporting period that an entity has set, but whether it's fiscal or calendar, it'll determine whether we award points or not based on, you know, when data was published on your website. So make sure that's correct. And secondly, if you ever move on beyond the public disclosure assessment and go on into one of our full assessments, such as the asset or the fund assessments, which are much more in depth, we use the reporting period even more strictly, and it applies in many more cases. So make sure that that is correct. Thirdly, you also will need to take into account the entity headquarter that we have set, because we use this entity headquarter variable to define the peer group in which you find yourselves. Lastly, some entity characteristics have been set as default, so please review them and make sure that they're correct. So the next step is to walk you through certain indicators. We'd like to first highlight that one of the things that makes this database quite handy and quite unique to the infrastructure industry is specifically the fact that we include materiality. So our asset assessments over the last 2 years has been including a materiality effect. And by this, we mean that for every indicator that we cover, there are certain issues that are nested within it. So you may think, for example, we may have a question on environmental policies or environmental objectives. The various policies that you have and the issues that are covered by it are for us to distinguish in terms of whether they are material to your assets operations or your fund operations or not. And therefore, in the public disclosure assessment we included this year, and because of the range of infrastructure sectors that exist out there, we've included two variables or two indicators which look at A, the primary location of your assets operations, and B, the primary sector in which it operates. These two indicators have an effect on a total because these are entity characteristics, these are reporting characteristics, sorry, they affect five indicators within the public disclosure assessment. And depending on the choices that you make in here, those five indicators will either have an impact on your score or not. And therefore, it allows for a much more granular assessment, but at the same time, should be done with carried out or filled out with caution and correctly. Do we have any questions at the moment, Aurelien?
Yes, we do. We have a question from Christine. Mm-hmm. And the question is, when will participants get the opportunity to amend data?
Right. So Christine, that's a good question. But actually, so what's happened is because you are already you would have already been a user, so your asset was already within the portal, it will only have appeared, so this assessment will have appeared under your view. So once you have clicked view assessments for your asset, you will see that there is a review and submit button there for your asset that will have appeared. It should be 98 or 100% complete, and you can go in and amend it. Now, the amending date, we will allow you to amend it until July 4th, and at that point, all assessments that haven't been submitted will be automatically submitted by our system. So yes, you should be able to, just to recap, you should be able to view it currently in your assessment portal under view assessments of the listed assets. Any other questions?
No.
Okay. So I know that the description that I've given now of materiality may be a little bit confusing and vague for some of you. So what we're going to be doing is releasing a document in the near future
to everyone and on our resources page that will further describe how materiality works and in a more intuitive way, using some tables to show you how these two materiality determinants that we've covered here, primary location, primary sector, affect the various issues and the various indicators throughout the assessment. So the first set of indicators that you'll be faced with are the disclosure methods. So these are a group of indicators that look at what types of reports the companies and the vehicles are releasing. We try to break it down into three sections. So it's normally the sustainability reports, the annual reports, and the integrated reports. For each of these, you'll need to apply what reporting year the report that you are giving to us in the evidence relates to. And that's where we're going to check whether, in terms of the reporting cycles, when you're reporting, because we have a rule whereby we accept an annual report from your current reporting year and also the year prior to it. So it's a two-year span. Here you also need to select whether you're reporting at an entity or a group level, as well as whether the report is aligned with certain sustainability reporting frameworks. So we think about, GRI or SASB and IIRC. And additionally, you can also earn more points if you have had it third-party verified or assured. So a lot of, annual reports, sustainability reports that we have seen do get, verified or assured by people like the Big Four. And that can also be something that you can add as a tick box in there. And make sure that when you provide the hyperlink, which we can see there at the bottom of the question, that you also clearly indicate where in the evidence or where in the documents the, in this case, the ESG data can be found, just to help us validate your responses much faster. Next, I think another one to have a look at is the objectives. So we have several questions on what types of objectives you have been setting. For each of these objectives, when you do add the evidence, we do award further points for cases where the objective is measurable and is time-bound. These are or, so you can have one or the other. Next, we have the section on policies. So the policies are a bit different in the sense that, and I wanted to highlight them because they're not tied to the reporting period in which that you have given us or that you state, because naturally a policy may have been set multiple years in the past, or some numerous years in the past, and has not been changed since then. So we do accept policy documents from further back in history. Lastly, I think what's also important to know with the policy documents is it can be quite tricky to define exactly what we accept as a policy. However, what we can guarantee to generally accept, is when you do provide us a separate document outside of any sustainability or annual report that has a full blown procedure that's been laid out on how you apply the policies, and additionally describing the process that takes place when the policy is breached, or the goal that the policy has to have implemented at the company. Next, we have the long-term reduction targets. So this indicator is a good example of how materiality will come into play. So depending on the sector and the primary sector and the primary location that you have decided upon, the different issues that are covered by this question will either be material to you or they won't be. And if they are material, they will impact your scoring. If they're not, then they won't. And the long-term targets, generally, as a rule, we want them to be at least 3 years or more into the future. So when we look through your reports or through your websites, we try to find cases of where the evidence shows that you have set targets for 3 years or more into the future on the topics that are laid out here. All right, so this next section is really, I think, quite an important one, and one that a lot of our participants get confused regarding. So we have two indicators within our assessment. The first one I'm showing here, D14, which is related to ESG management standards that exist. So whether you are accredited or aligned with these various standards. So here, when we talk about the requirements that are needed in order to be able to get points for this indicator, we're looking for evidence of alignment or accreditation with ESG-related management standards, which apply at the entity level. So in this case, we can think about the various ISOs that may exist out there. They're a good example of an entity level, standard that a company or a vehicle may be using in its management. And I've also additionally here added the two definitions that we include in our reference guide to help you further draw the boundaries on what is an accreditation, what is an alignment. We will look through the data and through the evidence that you provide to see if you align or are accredited with anything, and to draw the boundaries there. There's also a difference in scoring that's applied depending on which one you select. And secondly, I think so what a lot of people get confused by is drawing the line between this ESG-related management standard that I've just discussed and an asset-level certification. So we wanted to separate, rewarding points for having an entity-level standard versus having an actual project-level certification that's been awarded. So when we think about project-level certification, we're really thinking about a certification that's been given to a physical asset. So we think about LEED, BREEAM, the SHORE standard. These are all good examples of certifications that when we see have been applied to a building that you use in your operations or from multiple facilities in your infrastructure operations, we do award points for. We have also included the possibility to select energy ratings. This is because within the index and in the infrastructure, the global coverage index that GLIO provides to us, there are some REITs that exist. They are telecommunication tower REITs in general, but due to the inclusion of REITs in certain cases, and because there's this overlap sometimes between the real estate world and the infrastructure world, we decided to keep the energy rating possibility. So if you do have the energy labels and the ratings that come along with it, you may get points for that as well if you select it and provide the right evidence. So coming to what is the operational performance side of public disclosures assessment. From questions, I believe, D16 to D22, the indicators will cover the various operational performance aspects of your entity. So for each of the cases, such as here we have energy consumption, we look through all your reports and all the publicly available data where we can find, to see if we can find data on absolute consumption, like-for-like consumption, intensity data or portfolio data coverage. Whenever we find one of these, we're able to tick it and give you points for it. If you need any more guidance on what we exactly mean by the like for like intensity or portfolio data coverage, you may use the definitions that we use in our reference guide to guide you. If you're still unsure at that point, always feel free to reach out to us using our contact form, which you can find on our website. So we have one more question, apparently.
So another question from Christine. If one wishes to amend a response, do we just correct the answer directly in the questionnaire and this will be accepted?
Right. So the way that it works is that you can go in exactly and directly amend it. What happens at that point is that the portal will signal to the GRESB team that you have made a change. And using we have this response, validation portal where we can see all of the amendments that you have made. And they're all logged in there. So at that point, it'll trigger a flag for us, and we'll go have a look at the indicator, the changes that you've made, the new evidence that you've put in, and make a decision at that point. And normally, this all happens once you've submitted. So we will essentially, the best thing to do is once you've, once you're done amending everything as a whole, go ahead and submit it, and then we will review all the data and all the flags that come up at once. So output and scorecards. I think in the end, a lot of us are here because, as a participant, you would like to know what kind of information you're going to be giving to your investors, and hopefully, you know, for you, it'll be valuable data for them. It's what we provide generally is a scorecard for each company. So the way that it works is I've highlighted here some of the key items. Each company receives their own scorecard. So if you are participants, you will receive a free scorecard at the end of the of the assessments and the assessment cycle. So each scorecard will include what we call a public disclosure level, a PD level, as well as a GRESB score. So the levels range from A to E. And it's on a, you know, because the assessment is out of 100 points, it obviously drops in quintiles. And we also provide a GRESB score if that asset also participated in our asset assessment. Additionally, you will be able to see here on the right-hand side a PD disclosure level. So you will have the same sort of A to E system working, but not as a total score, but a sort of a subset score based on the four different topics that we cover. So in the public disclosure assessment, we cover, so we break down the indicators into four sections, as you can see in the screenshot that we've presented here. And that will be included in your scorecard as well, and it'll show you where you stand on the various topics in terms of your the amount of transparency that you're giving to the public, as well as where your peers stand on average, and where the entire GRESB public disclosure universe stands. So it's a pretty handy tool for that. And lastly, we also provide you the peer group and the name of the constituents that make up your peer group in the third screenshot at the bottom of the slide here. This can be very useful for you to understand what you're being compared to. And here we've used the real estate example from last year, so we'll be developing our own soon. And the peer groups will be determined based off, as I mentioned earlier, your headquarter location, as well as your sector. And so this brings us also to my last slide, that the investors, essentially, as I've mentioned a couple of times, will be able to view every single scorecard that we have. So you as a participant only get to see your own, but an investor who's subscribed with us gets to see all the scorecards out there. And we also are currently building or are attempting to build a downloadable file, which will include all the variables and the indicators that we cover into a format that easily, you know, can be used in decision making and for better comparison between all the different assets and funds that we have covered in the public disclosure assessment. So that brings it to a close from my end. Obviously, we can leave it open for questions if anyone wants to type some out. Otherwise, if there aren't any, we can definitely, you know, can definitely direct your questions to the contact form, and they will be sent either to me or Aurelian, and we'll be able to handle them from there. The recording of this webinar will also be put on our website and will be sent to you because you registered for this webinar as soon as it's ready. Normally it should be in a few hours or Monday morning, whenever it's processed by WebEx. And that's about it. So thanks a lot for joining us. We appreciate it. We will now then, you know, leave it open for questions if anyone wants to send them through. But otherwise, that's it for me. So thank you very much.